One, thanks so much for joining me this Saturday. I'm Frederica Whitfield. We begin with this breaking news, a major shakeup coming to the White House. President Trump last hour confirming that Chief of Staff John Kelly will leave his post at the White House at the end of the year. Here's the president moments ago.
John Kelly will be leaving, I don't know if I can say retiring, but he's a great guy. John Kelly will be leaving at the end of the year. We'll be announcing who will be taking John's place. It might be on an interim basis. I'll be announcing that over the next day or two. But John will be leaving at the end of the year. He's been with me almost 2 years now, as you know, between the two positions. So we're probably going to see him in a little while. But John Kelly, ready? Are you ready? So John Kelly will be leaving toward the end of the year, at the end of the year. And I appreciate his service very much.
Kelly's departure comes amid CNN's reporting that he and the president have not been on speaking terms in recent days, and that the chief of staff recently sat down with the special counsel in the Russia investigation. CNN White House reporter Sarah Westwood joins us now from Philadelphia. That's where the Army-Navy game is going to be taking place as soon as the president, who's on his way there, will be doing the coin toss. So this major announcement before he arrives, Sarah.
That's right, Fred. President Trump ended months of speculation about whether White House Chief of Staff John Kelly was eyeing the exits when he announced that his embattled chief of staff will, in fact, be leaving in the weeks ahead. Their relationship had deteriorated in recent months. The president had begun circumventing some of the policies that Kelly had put in place to create order in the West Wing. And our colleague Caitlin Collins reporting yesterday that Kelly and Trump were no longer on speaking terms. Their relationship, widely viewed within the White House, is no longer tenable. And that's just an incredible shift from just a few months ago in July, when the White House made a big show of publicizing the fact that Trump had asked his chief of staff to stay on through 2020 to try to quell some of that perennial speculation about Kelly's future in the West Wing that we've seen him survive in the past. Of course, the announcement of Kelly's departure comes just one day after CNN reported that Kelly sat down with investigators from special counsel Robert Mueller's team to answer questions about alleged obstruction. Of justice occurring in the White House. So, of course, Kelly's departure is going to come as the White House attempts to navigate these new developments in the Russia investigation. As all of that has been unfolding, Trump has been announcing a series of major personnel changes. Just this morning, he announced his new pick to be the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Mark Milley. That came a day after he announced his new attorney general pick, Bill Barr, his new pick for UN Ambassador Heather Nauert to replace outgoing Ambassador Nikki Haley. The president has just another high-profile appointment to make to replace Kelly. And while Nick Ayers, Vice President Mike Pence's chief of staff, is said to be the leading contender, that's just another major staffing decision that the president has to make and unveil in the days ahead, Fred.
Right. And the president did say on the lawn there that, you know, the next person might be temporary. He seemed like he wasn't so certain about the next pick.
That's right. An interim appointment is what we saw at the Justice Department, certainly when he implemented Matt Whitaker in that position, who has held it for several weeks until the president settled on Bill Barr for that position. It's something that he's done in the past to fill other positions and until he's made them permanent. For instance, that's what he did to replace Rob Porter. He elevated Derek Lyons to that position in acting capacity and eventually made him the permanent staff secretary. So that's something that the president could potentially do to try out a new chief of staff. He said he'll be announcing that decision in the next day or two, Fred.
All right, Sarah Westwood in Philadelphia, thank you so much. Again, the president will be arriving there, and he'll be doing the coin toss for the Army-Navy game. All right, let's bring in Lynn Sweet, the Washington Bureau Chief at the Chicago Sun-Times, CNN's Chief Media Correspondent Brian Stelter. All right, good to see you both.
So,
Trump says his chief of staff will be out at the end of the year. So, Lynn, your thoughts on this?
Well, my thoughts is that this is going to just be the start of a very even more chaotic chapter in the presidential life of Donald Trump, because he will just have to start getting adjusted to either being his own chief of staff, which is what he probably prefers operationally, and whether or not he can deal with all this new personnel coming in at one time. What we're really talking about is more than just a routine midterm change. This is an upheaval for Trump, who is not necessarily demonstrated that he could deal with all these streams of change at one time, because we should not just look at this chief of staff as one change in isolation. It's many, and on top of all the stuff that's going to happen when the Democrats take over the House and the Mueller probes come to a head.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so the timing is interesting, Brian, because, you know, the president, on the lawn said, you know, I'm not sure if he's retiring or, you know, if he's just, you know, ending his term with me. It was just kind of strange that even the president seemed a little uncertain on that. But then our Caitlin Collins had reported that they were not on speaking terms. And then, you know, Caitlin has also just said that, based on information that she's learned from her sources, that apparently, yes, President Trump and John Kelly had discussed his departure over the last 24 hours, according to a source, but it was not the plan to announce it on the South lawn.
Interesting. We've seen this before from President Trump. He sometimes tries to get ahead of some sort of pre-planned or staged announcement. Maybe that's because he's trying to define the conversation or define the terms of the conversation. We will see what Kelly's side of this story is, because we've only heard Trump's side right now. But Trump's side is that Kelly will be leaving by the end of the year. And your point you made earlier with Sarah about the interim nature of the next appointment is also noteworthy. I mean, we can't ignore the headlines of the last 12 hours while talking about Kelly. The president's been implicated in crimes. And that raises the question, who wants to work for this president?
Yeah.
Who wants to work with him? Rex Tillerson yesterday quoted as saying, this is a president who would oftentimes want to do things that would break the law. And I have to tell him, you can't do that, sir. This is a president who doesn't want to read briefings, et cetera. So it raises this question of who wants to go to work at the White House and work for a president who is in this precarious situation. Yeah. But I do think it is worth noting, this is a very hard job. Chief of staff, this is a really difficult job. Barack Obama went through at least 5 chiefs of staff during his 8 years. George W. Bush only went through 2 chiefs of staff, though, in his entire 8 years. Now Trump, after 2 years, has been through 2 chiefs of staff as well. And take a look at what President Trump said in 2012 about Obama's turnovers with chief of staff. This is a direct quote here from then-businessman Donald Trump in 2012 saying, 3 chiefs of staff in less than 3 years of being president. That's part of the reason why Barack Obama can't manage to pass his agenda. Obviously, at the end of 2 years, now President Trump will have 3 chiefs of staff.
Yeah, and so, you know, Lynn, is it a big demerit? Is it something, negative for a White House to go through several chiefs of staff? Or, given it is a very prestigious position, and there is burnout, this is a tough 24-hour kind of gig,
right.
You know, can it just simply be accepted that, you know, a president will go through many chiefs of staff?
Yes and no. As Obama's first chief of staff, Rahm Emanuel, once famously said, the White House is family friendly. That is, for the president's family. Everyone.
Not
everyone
for anybody else. Right, right.
Absolutely. But I would just counsel everyone to see this for what it is. This is a churn of personnel. This isn't just the normal burnout. Rahm Emanuel left Obama to go run for mayor of Chicago. Bill Daley was there for a time, yes, and then there was an interim, and then Dennis McDonough was there till the end. What is interesting to know today is, but you talk about why people come into the Trump administration. How unprofessional, in a sense, or unseemly you treat a man who has given a lifetime of service to our nation in the military and then in the White House, and you kind of toss him aside in an offhand comment, talking to reporters. The president's not even sure, is he retiring or what? How can one person just do that to someone?
But he did
else?
Thank him for his service.
Well, it doesn't really seem to come through when you kind of announce it this way. There are nice ways to give somebody a more fitting
exit. Yeah, some
exit.
Formality, on the lawn at a podium, and usually there is a very dignified transition and announcement.
Or you have a
when it's amicable,
press release,
particularly,
or something. Or he treated Nikki Haley; she got to announce her departure on her terms, even if there's acrimony. What does this say, especially on the day as you go to the Army-Navy game, which is a game of a great rivalry of one military that works together for the nation at one time? that you're dealing with a man who has devoted his years to the military like this, it just goes... I almost don't know what more to say about what this says about the commander-in-chief. Just because he didn't get along with him, that's reasonable. He should pick his own chief, find someone who you could work with. That's okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Brian, that is a bit of a sour there. Here he is going to Army-Navy game, you know, John Kelly with his military service, and to kind of make this announcement, even though he did say thank you for, you know, he thanks him for his service. It does create a very awkward situation.
Yeah, it does, and we won't really know, I think, the backstory for a little while. You know, Kelly apparently wasn't speaking with the president in recent mm-hmm. days. Then there's the headlines yesterday about Kelly being interviewed by the Mueller probe. There's a lot to fill in the blanks here, but I'm interested in hearing Kelly's side of the story, Kelly's account of what happened. And it's also curious to see if Kelly's going to move into a new role in the government or elsewhere, right? Trump said it doesn't, you know, maybe retiring, maybe not. We don't know. That was a curious comment from the president.
That was very curious.
But I agree with Lynn. This is about a broader sense of turmoil and a broader challenge recruiting and retaining talent in this administration that is racked by scandal.
Mm-hmm. All right. We'll leave it there for now. Thanks so much, Lynn Sweet, Brian Stelter. Good to see you guys.
Thanks.
And thank you.
All right. Still ahead, court filings shed new insights into the investigation surrounding President Trump. Prosecutors now implicating the president. All right, welcome back now to the latest in the Russia probe. Stunning new memos are giving us unprecedented insight. Federal prosecutors now are implicating the president of the United States in two federal crimes during the 2016 presidential campaign. And in another memo, Mueller says former Trump campaign chairman Paul Manafort lied about five major things, including how long he stayed in touch with White House officials after he was indicted. CNN's Sarah Murray joins me right now. So the president has just said that he's happy about the Mueller's filing and everything that's been gleaned from it. What more can you tell us?
Yeah, perhaps maybe overly optimistic about what these filings include, but I'll let you hear it directly from the president. Here's what he had to say, his take on the Mueller filings today.
On the Mueller situation, we're very happy with what we are reading because there was no collusion whatsoever. There never has been. The last thing I want is help from Russia on a campaign. You should ask Hillary Clinton about Russia because she financed the fake dossier, which I understand they tried to get some information and help from Russia. But you ought to ask them about that. Very one-sided situation, but I think it's all turning around very nicely. But as far as the report that we see, according to everybody I've spoken to, I have not read it. There's absolutely no collusion, which is very important.
Now, Fred, in actuality, a lot of people around President Trump were in contact with the Russians. And as you pointed out, he's now been implicated in two federal crimes. But for some reason, he seems very happy about the situation.
And then what can you tell us about these, you know, hush money payments, the president's role, what's being revealed?
Right. I mean, these are the crimes that President Trump has now been implicated in. We heard Michael Cohen talk about them previously in court. But this is the first time prosecutors are the ones who are saying that Cohen paid off these women at Donald Trump's direction, then a candidate Trump. And they say the principal purpose of the payment to one of these women was to prevent her story from influencing the election. So it was to manipulate voters, to manipulate the campaign. And because of this and because of the other crimes Cohen committed, the Southern District of New York came down pretty hard on him. And they said that he deserves a substantial term of imprisonment. So they only suggested slightly less than what the guidelines would have, the sentencing guidelines would have stated. There's no, like, great deal that the Southern District of New York thinks Michael Cohen deserves.
And what more is really being revealed about this Trump Tower project in Moscow?
Well, obviously, we learned that Michael Cohen lied when he went before Congress. He lied that when he said the Trump Tower deal in Moscow, you know, fell apart much sooner than it actually did. And the reason that this is so interesting is because the fact that Mueller's team has focused on this tells you that they are interested in it as part of their collusion investigation. They are interested in this business deal that did appear to go belly up. We also learned, though, in terms of Cohen's cooperation with the special counsel, that there was another Russian national that approached him. This one was in November of 2015. This was a person who said they could help create political synergy and synergy on a government level, someone who offered to try to set up a meeting with candidate Trump and Russian President Vladimir Putin. That meeting apparently never happened. But the other notable thing the special counsel pointed out is that Michael Cohen was still in touch with the White House this year. About what? We still don't know that, Fred.
All right, Sarah Murray, thanks so much. All right, joining me now to discuss, Lynn Sweet is back with me, and we're joined by former federal prosecutor and counsel for Democrats on impeachment, on the impeachment of Clinton. Liz Wiehl is with us. All right, so good to see you all, ladies. Lynn, your reaction to the president who, you know, said on, you know, from the White House before boarding Marine One, saying, you know, he's happy with the way things.
I don't know if Mrs. Trump is going to be happy, because in that 40-page document, it talks about how individual one, who is her husband, the president, worked with Michael Cohen to pay off women who he was having allegedly intimate contact with. So I don't know. That might not be legal trouble for the president, but it sure doesn't look good for his personal behavior. But it seems that President Trump is focused just on the question of collusion, mm-hmm. not seemingly to realize in his statement of happiness that he has serious problems now because of the details revealed in the documents filed yesterday in both the Manafort and Cohn cases.
So, Liz, do you see this as very serious, or is this, you know, the president when he says he's happy about the filings, this is just a, you know, don't let him see you sweat kind of moments?
Well, of course.
But then don't he's sweating.
Yeah, then he's sweating. Look, he's cloaked himself with these guys who have now been convicted of all of these lies, and he's cloaked himself with liars. He's been the hub in this wheel of conspiracies. Now you see all the spokes of these wheels now being convicted of lying. And after, in Manafort, with individual one being Trump, in the center of the wheel, the hub of the wheel, sending out those spokes. That is a conspiracy. That is what looks like Mueller is actually showing here, and what we're going to probably see come down the road in a report.
And Lynn, listen to what the president, you know, said just moments ago compared to his words in July of 2016.
There was no collusion whatsoever. There never has been. The last thing I want is help from Russia on a campaign.
Russia, if you're listening, I hope you're able to find the 30,000 emails that are missing.
So, Lynn, no one can forget that moment.
Well, one person can, apparently President Trump.
Well, maybe he wants everyone to forget about it.
Well, that video where he invited Russia to come is maybe not legally fortified. I don't know how the legal implication of him saying that, if that will count in the narrative where you're trying to put together the leaked emails. You know, as we're talking about, there's a lot of moving parts here to go with it. And one other thing, it could be true, and what Trump doesn't see here, it may be that he personally never colluded. But what you have is evidence that people in his campaign did. And that's the charge of Manafort, of Special Counsel Mueller. It's on that is his charge, is to look for collusion in the campaign. That is the point of endangerment that President Trump doesn't seem to realize. It doesn't have to be him talking to a Russian in order to make these various cases. And that is, I don't think that's a subtle point of difference. I think it's one that is just not clear to the president right now.
And that also goes to obstruction and conspiracy. That also goes to the exact same thing.
Right. So
when you have
obstruction and conspiracy, this become reference points of suspicion of those things.
Exactly. That's exactly right. When you have something like a conspiracy, a larger criminal act, then you have people acting in concert. It doesn't mean that individual one or Trump or whatever does all of the overt acts himself. He sends people out to do different things because people are acting in concert. So, you know, one person doesn't do every act themselves. People are working as a unit together. Mm-hmm. So just because, so if the president says, well, I didn't go to attend X meeting, or I didn't do, certain thing. Of course he didn't, because he had other people do it for them.
So Liz, are his attorneys just going bonkers here, that he just cannot, you know, the president will not stop commenting, you know, about whether it's, you know, the filings or, you know, just talking off the cuff? And, I mean, his attorneys cannot want him to just keep talking, because can't the Mueller team come back for some follow-up questions, particularly after this?
I thought what was interesting is we heard earlier, I think it was just today, that we heard some rumblings that the Trump team wants to come back with a report, sort of a rebuttal report when the Mueller team does issue its report. Now, I sat there when Kenneth Starr issued his report. I was there and at the House committee. I was there with them when he issued the report. There was no, you know, Democrats didn't issue a rebuttal. We listened to what Kenneth Starr, you know, what the report said, and listened to it, and then the articles of impeachment were actually meted out. So that's not how it works, you know. So it said to me, that was very interesting. I smell like that seems kind of desperate.
It hasn't happened.
Right? How can you issue a rebuttal report when you haven't even gotten the report yet? It doesn't make sense.
Or even if they do, it wouldn't necessarily go to be part of any conclusion that Mueller reaches. They might do this just for public relations, so they could have their report. But I'll tell you, the real jury are going to be the members of the Democratic-run House Judiciary Committee. And when we covered Clinton's impeachment, that was a Republican committee. So you kind of see where we're going on this one.
You got it, exactly.
Swearing in January 3rd. All right, Lynn Sweet, Liz Wheel, good to see you both. Thank you.
Got it.
Thanks. All right, still ahead, more bombshells from Mueller's court filings. We're now learning Trump's former campaign manager, Paul Manafort, has been in contact with current White House officials this year and lied to Trump campaign chairman. Paul Manafort lied to his investigators. In all, Mueller accuses Manafort of lying about five key issues after agreeing to cooperate with prosecutors. The big one has to do with texts that show Manafort lied about contact with the Trump administration this year. CNN politics reporter Jeremy Herb joins us now. The filing is the first, you know, time prosecutors have laid out the why and the how that they believe Manafort breached his plea agreement. What else is there?
Yeah, you know, several of these lies are potentially significant. One of the things that Mueller says that Manafort lied about was his interactions with Konstantin Kilimnik, who is a Russian national close to Manafort that prosecutors say has ties to Russian intelligence. Now, this is potentially significant because there have been lots of speculation swirling about Kilimnik's role in the collusion, if there was any potential collusion. And we don't know from this filing exactly what Manafort and Kilimnik were talking about, because much of that section is redacted. So Mueller has something there, but we don't know yet what it is. The other key lie is, as you said, Mr. Manafort's communications with several administration officials, including one senior administration official, as Mueller put it. And Mueller has evidence of these contacts through conversations and text messages. We don't know yet who he was talking to or why he was having these communications.
Are there any inferences about what they could have been talking about?
You know, I think with both this filing and the Michael Cohen filing, Mueller has left breadcrumbs and kind of hinted at what may have been the case. You know, there isn't anything that says it was about X. Mueller cares about it and put it in the filing because Manafort denied having any direct communications with members of the Trump administration. But that said, there likely is some sort of underlying reason he was talking about it, and we may or maybe not learn it at a later date.
And so what might this mean for a Manafort when it comes down to sentencing? I mean, he likely would be penalized for that kind of breach, wouldn't he?
Oh, absolutely. We don't know yet what the special counsel is going to do, but there's the potential for additional criminal charges for Manafort as a result of this violation of his plea agreement. He's already facing charges because he, for the conviction he had in Virginia earlier this year, and for pleading guilty in a Washington, D.C. court. So he's facing sentencing starting next month, but there could be additional sentences on top of that in addition to just the violation of the plea agreement here.
All right. Jeremy Herb, thanks so much.
Thank you.
All right, still ahead, President Trump nominates a new attorney general. Who is he and how will he handle? A familiar face could head up the Justice Department for the second time in his life. President Trump has nominated former Attorney General Bill Barr as the permanent replacement to Jeff Sessions. Barr served as Attorney General under the late President George H.W. Bush and was the boss of Robert Mueller, who led the DOJ's criminal division at the time. Former U.S. Attorney Harry Littman wrote an op-ed in the Washington Post calling himself, quote, one Democrat who thinks Trump made an excellent choice with the Barr nomination. And he joins me right now. Harry, good to see you. So why is
Thanks,
this an
Frederica.
Excellent choice?
Look, you know, we've been bemoaning for a while the installation of a yes man or possible crony atop the Mueller investigation and the Department of Justice, someone who might tamp down on the investigation or funnel information to the White House. Bill Barr is nobody's yes man and nobody's crony. He fully understands the importance of the depoliticization of law enforcement, and he has the sort of stature and experience to stand up for it. So that's three quarters of the battle here, I think, that kind of insulation so Mueller can do his job. The other quarter, there is, I can foresee possibilities where there are principal disagreements between him and Mueller about how to proceed. But so long as you have an institutionalist, someone who's of the department, believes in the department, understands the importance of the White House's not breaching that wall that they've basically clobbered over the last couple years, we are really way ahead of where we mm-hmm. have been.
Well, you just said it. You know, he is institutional, and Trump campaigned on being kind of the anti-establishment. And Mr. Barr is Washington establishment. So what do you suppose precipitated this nomination?
Yeah. You know, I think people have said to me, well, if he's so good, why did Trump pick him? But of course, if that's right, then there'd be no possibility. I think Trump understood, especially with the terrific blowback to the ill-fated choice of Matt Whitaker, that he really needed someone. He needed both to have a confirmed nominee and someone who had the Washington stature, who, as you say, is not a bomb thrower from the outside, is mm-hmm. Republican, conservative, but will have the confidence, especially of the Senate, to do the right thing as far as the institutional prerogatives of the Department of Justice go. So yeah. I think it's probably a move that he was sort of forced into, might not be thrilled about, but it was a political imperative.
So in your op-ed in the Washington Post, you write, you know, Barr plainly has the stature and the character to stand up for the department's institutional prerogatives and to push back on any improper attempt to inject politics into its work. And to this extent, he is a sea change from Trump's ill-advised, even shameful installation of the unqualified yes man, Matthew G. Whitaker, as acting attorney general and presumptive supervisor of the Russia collusion probe being run by former FBI Director Robert Mueller III. So help elaborate on that, because, you know, the president has made it very clear that he wants people who are loyal to him. And it sounds like you're describing Mr. Barr as being anything but loyal to a person, but loyal to the institution.
I think that is where his first loyalty lies and where any attorney general's first loyalty should lie. Look, he's obviously of the party. I have no doubt he voted for the president, but that's nothing new. You've had such pressure on the department over the last couple years. It's demoralized the rank and file. Several times the Congress and the White House have shaken it down to get information. You just can't do that with a Bill Barr. I don't want to portray him as a maverick who will be looking to slap the president around. He can't do that and won't do that. But I think he will gird against any attempts for the mm-hmm. department to be breached in it has been over the last few years.
Is it at all worrisome, however, that Mr. Barr has been critical of the Mueller probe? And that's why he might be appealing to President Trump?
Well, I think this is a possible appeal for the president, and as I mentioned, I can see specific points where he and Mueller would have principal disagreements. Of course, as you mentioned, Barr was there when Mueller was the head of the criminal division, and surely shares, I was there at the time as well, by the way, and he surely shares the universal respect for Mueller's professionalism, which Trump denigrates daily. Can you see ways in which it would peck at the margins? Yes. Nevertheless, given where we are and where we could be, the fact that you will have somebody at the helm who understands the importance of protecting the institution of the department against political interference is, I think, the headline. Mm. And what you mention is a subsidiary issue to think about. But I think for now, the biggest point is the strength and stature of Barr.
All right. Harry Lipman, we'll leave it there for now. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So much more straight ahead in the newsroom, but first.
I'm Casey Lin, a Muay Thai boxer. Muay Thai boxing is Thai kickboxing. You're allowed to use knees and elbows and clinch. When I got in Muay Thai, it was never about self-defense. What I wanted to do was build my trust in men again. I'm a domestic violence survivor. I dated this guy, started deteriorating, and he threatened to kill my family. He started hitting me. And then he pulled out a revolver and threatened me. He stalked me for like a year and a half. I got out of it because he robbed a place and went to jail. Coming out of a domestic violence past, walking into a gym where men hitting other people and like very few women it was a big, big hurdle. When I first started sparring, all of the beauty that just makes you a fighter. I'm an amateur level fighter. I fought over the US in South Thailand and